from Simon & Schuster Audio. Our sacred honor. Words of advice from the founders in stories, letters, poems, and speeches. Edited with commentary by William J. Bennett. Read by Philip Bosco, Barry Bostwick, Mary Stuart Masterson, Campbell Scott, David Strathairn, and Fritz Weaver. With narration by Jesse Boggs. And an introduction by William J. Bennett.
It is famously recorded that upon the conclusion of the Constitutional Convention of 1787, a Mrs. Powell of Philadelphia asked Dr. Franklin, "Well, doctor, what have we got, a republic or a monarchy?" "A republic," replied the doctor, "if you can keep it." But how are we to keep our republic? In truth, this question, Franklin's question, is little asked or pondered today. And to the extent that it is, we answer that our political system is a machine that will go of itself, powered by such mechanisms as the separation of powers, federalism, checks and balances, clashing political factions, free elections, pluralism, interest groups, and so on and so forth. Well, to some extent it does work this way, which was part of the founders' plan. They believed that institutional arrangements would be central to the success of a modern republic, and Americans are rightfully proud to possess the world's longest-lasting and most imitated written political document, the Constitution. Yet, even with such extraordinary political instruments and institutions, the founders were aware that the American Republic would not, over the long haul, be so easily maintained. From their study of history, the founders had learned of the travails of republics before this one, how the republics of old had, in time, been destroyed by convulsions and upheavals, by vice and decadence. And from their study of human nature, they became acutely aware of man's self-interestedness and his selfishness, designing America's political institutions to take these things into account. They concluded that while such institutional supports were absolutely necessary and could do much to rechannel and curb individual selfishness and discourage convulsions and decline, something more would be needed if this republic was to survive. As John Adams put it, "Human passions, unbridled by morality and religion, would break the strongest cords of our Constitution as a whale goes through a net." Well, the gritty and noble work of securing the Republic, then, would in the final analysis have to be done by individuals of decent and reasonable character. Only a people prepared with the right dispositions, with the right mores, with tempered but strong religious beliefs, would be able to keep what the founders had bequeathed to them in 1776. In other words, the arduous task of sustaining the American Republic would fall upon us, upon you and me, upon the millions yet unborn, as Washington then put it. The question of how to secure the Republic is then the question of what sort of people we must be. This is why I have chosen to offer to the American public a program on the founders' vision of the virtues that they believed necessary for sustaining the American experiment. As the poet Robert Frost observed, the vision of the founders was to occupy the land with character, with people in self-control. Fortunately for us, the founding fathers had much to say about the virtues and vices of a free people. Though it is nowhere as systematically presented as their analysis of political institutions, it is there for those who look, and it is necessary for each generation of Americans to look. For as Lincoln warned, "The great deeds and virtues of the founding generation grow more and more dim by the lapse of time." How can Americans fully know this country and themselves without knowing at least a little about the men and women who pledged and risked their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor for the blessings of liberty we enjoy today? Thus, in preparing this program, I reviewed the private letters, public addresses, and pamphlets of the founders to bring to light once again their answers. My aim was to share with a new generation of Americans the private and public reflections of the founding generation on what we must do to make America great. This program, then, is about our virtues, the virtues the founders thought essential for the success of the American experiment. The virtues I've chosen to highlight in this collection are patriotism and courage, civility and friendship, love and courtship, education of the head and heart, industry and frugality, justice and piety. Of course, these virtues are not the exclusive property of the American people. But having said that, I would emphasize that there is something very American about these virtues. America would dazzle the world, not by its regal splendor, but by adopting the virtues peculiar to a free people. If I were asked, wherein lies the spirit of America, I say it is here, in our capacity to govern ourselves, to excel in public and private virtue.
Patriotism and courage. As every American knows, the first part of the Declaration of Independence establishes the rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Nothing, it seems, could be more fundamental to Americans than the protection of these rights. We are all well aware of them, and these days not shy about asserting them. However, few Americans pay enough attention to the last line of the Declaration of Independence. There, Jefferson wrote, "We mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor." These are not empty words. They are as important as the opening paragraphs of the Declaration. Rights are important, but just as we have a just claim on our rights, so our honor, our sacred honor, has a claim on us. The 56 men who signed the Declaration of Independence and the other leaders of the American Revolutionary War would either become glorious founders of a new nation, or they would swing from the gallows. As Benjamin Rush said, his fellow signers of the Declaration knew they were signing their own death warrants. While writing his bold and now famous signature, John Hancock, the first to sign, reportedly said, "There, His Majesty can now read my name without glasses, and he can double the reward on my head." To encourage solidarity, Hancock later told the delegates who were preparing to sign the document that they must all hang together, to which Benjamin Franklin supposedly quipped, "We must all hang together or we most assuredly will hang separately." Most of the signers of the Declaration of Independence, as well as other Americans, suffered for their devotion to the cause of independence. Many had to flee their homes. Many lost their property and their fortunes, which they and their families never recovered. A few died in battle. One of the sentiments that moved them to make these sacrifices was patriotism. Patriotism means love of country, and it can call for great sacrifices and courage, perhaps even for the sacrifice of one's own life. We don't have as keen a sense of that now as did the founders. Though the word patriotism, from the Latin pater, for father, implies a familial connection, love of country is in fact different from all other attachments. We have natural ties to our families, and sacrificing for loved ones is something each of us does every day. But sacrificing for our country requires a commitment to something more abstract and distant. It requires that we sacrifice our self-interest and private attachments for the sake of the common interest and public good for people we have never seen, for those who have gone before, and for those who will come after us. And in America, what brings forth our patriotism, our greatest sacrifices, is our steadfast devotion to the ideals of freedom and equality. American patriotism, in short, is not based on tribe or family, but on principle, law, and liberty. Thomas Jefferson, The Declaration of Independence. In the concluding section of the Declaration of Independence, written by Thomas Jefferson, the founders announced that the United States is a free and independent country, separate from and no longer subject to Great Britain. To achieve this goal, they vowed to dedicate our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.